Hello, coffee drinkers. Today we are talking about what probably almost every professional musician has ever done and what a lot of amateur musicians I'm sure have done as well. And we all do it differently. We all have different methods, different shorthand versions of this, and it is simply writing a chart for a gig and how we work in shorthand and how we write little cues down on a piece of paper where we're not writing out the full detail of the song, but we're writing out enough information so we can get from the start to the finish without a train wreck, without annoying the band leader, and without getting fired. Chelsea is doing this right now for a gig tomorrow.
Hello.
This is also not staged at all, I am happy to report, because she literally poked her head around the corner. She's like, hey babe, what are you doing the vlog on today? Remember we said we were gonna talk about writing charts? Well, I'm doing that right now. So look at this, this is like the chicken scratch pencil. Is that like the chicken scratch pencil and then you're moving to?
Yeah, so I transcribed, this is the very first time I ever listened to the song and I transcribed it. And it did the job for the first gig, which was a showcase thing in a really cool studio where I could have this on a music stand right in front of my face. But tomorrow I'm gonna be playing a giant festival in front of hundreds of thousands of people and I can't look at really light crap pencil on a giant stage. So in comes the Sharpie and the iPad. So what I'm gonna do is do this in Sharpie, scan it in the printer, make it into a book, put it on the iPad, and suddenly you're a pro.
It's actually been kind of a long time since I did this, but I'm also gonna share some of my really janky charts. She's laughing already, she hasn't even seen them. And it's amazing though about the shorthand thing, like, Can I borrow this?
Yeah.
Okay, so if I look at this, right, if I look at this chart right here, it's great that it's super clear in terms of the form. I love the form. So I can actually look at this and get a great idea of the form, even though I've never heard the song and I've never played it, but this would not get me from the beginning to the end of the song because this is personal to Chelsea. This is Chelsea's shorthand and there are some rhythm things there.
I actually taught myself how to read music this way. Weirdly. Well, I played classical violin when I was really little, so the music, reading music was very familiar to me in treble clef. And then I started playing bass at church where the chords are really simple, but there's a lot of maybe sudden upbeats to remember, or the chorus the third time does this instead of that. So I invented my own shorthand almost before I started playing bass. The things kind of happened at the same time for me. So I have a lot of notes to myself that I just know exactly what I meant. And even if I haven't heard the song in a long time, I just know that that's what it means.
So the more people's charts I look at, there's no real universal way of doing this. There's no like, oh, this is the exact way to do it. It's not like traditional notation when you're handing a score to someone for an orchestra or whatever it is. It's really kind of can be completely, you know, you might get two people write a cheat sheet chart for the same song and be completely different in the way they notate it. Basic similarities in terms of the form, I'm sure, but the actual notation of it, kind of different. So this was Chelsea's chart that kind of sparked the idea to make a vlog about this. This is like this really made to go on the floor, to be really visible. Bright red, large chord names. Again, on this one, the form in these boxes on the edge is even bigger. And still, it's kind of still old school to do it on paper, and what Chelsea just said about putting it into the iPad and having that up on the stand is super useful. And then you don't have thousands of pieces of paper floating around if you're playing in multiple bands and all that stuff. So technology has definitely changed that process for the better, I think. Kind of wish that had been around 15 years ago when I was doing a lot more of this. I knew these old postcards from 2007 for the Live at the 55 Bar recording would come in useful. They're bookmarks for my book, this super old book where I wrote a lot of cheat sheets. I put up a few examples of like different stuff that I've had to use over the years. The first one being like kind of really specific bassline stuff. This is a band I played in called Dap Theory, which was like really complicated music in terms of the components. But once I had each of those components down, it was kind of easier to remember the form of the song. We didn't get to play too much. It wasn't like we were doing runs of dates, so that information didn't like sit in the brain. It didn't get ingrained in the brain as much as I would have liked, so I needed a kind of a refresher and a reboot every time we went out to play a random one-off show. So I would have little parts of the bass line. I'd have the song, And then just the notation for like A section and B section. And some of the tunes were literally just A and B sections. And then it was really a lot about the improvisation and the interaction between the band, which makes it easy to do notated cheat sheets when it's not a long, through-composed, complex piece of music. So that's what, as you can see, what I did a lot of with Dap Theory. Like on two pages, that's like an entire set of music, maybe even two sets. Because I did memorize a bunch of the songs. If I could memorize like five or six of the songs and then get 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 more on the cheat sheet, that was all I needed. Man, and then it continues. This will be another set on the next two pages. And it's giving me hives just looking at this. It was like, this was anxiety-producing music to play. Incredible musicians, and I just don't think at the time my heart was 100% in it. I was probably the wrong person for the gig, which is why I didn't end up doing it more than a couple of years. And there were times where it was awesome and had a lot of fun, but this is how I got through that. That was like a high-pressure, complex music gig. And then I come to some stuff, you know, very similar to the way Chelsea was doing it in terms of the form and having, you know, intro, chorus, verse, and just being able to write the changes out for the intro, which were also the chorus changes, and then one set of changes for the verse, and then just literally writing the words intro, chorus, verse, chorus to get the form of the song from the top to the bottom. And this looks like, again, like what Chelsea was saying about where she had the luxury of being in a studio where she could have the sheet music up on a stand and it wasn't like a high pressure thing, not live in front of like 100,000 people. So this was also from a record date. So it was super relaxed and low key, and I was able to just have to have this right in front of me. I wasn't like dealing with, you know, weather and wind blowing the music away or all of those things that we deal with when we're playing live in outdoor situations. And then another shorthand thing I do to expedite the process when I'm arranging and writing for horns or producing albums or working in the studio in that environment will be to write a super compact piano score. These are actually the horn parts for Mystery to Me, the title track on my very first album, and they're literally written out in piano score. They're not even identified as to the orchestration because it was done really kind of at the last minute on the way to the studio. So I had in my head exactly what I wanted and who I wanted to play them. That's really minimalist. And if you go back and listen to that album, it's quite arranged and it's quite involved and complex. And we did overdubs afterwards. That was one of the only tunes we really added things to because the whole record was done live. And that is exactly how I did it, though. That was how the chart was written. I didn't hand music to the horn players when they were overdubbing on that. I just kind of gave them this piano score and directed a really quick way of getting to it, actually, rather than having a huge stack of parts. It's a benefit of working with your friends and working with people who are super quick in all areas of getting music from you or from a piece of paper and out onto the record. And it goes on, these are all the parts, the time stands still, and like all the stacked horn parts on the bridge. Again, super shorthand, piano score, nothing fancy at all. But I think what it boils down to from what Chelsea said, from my experience as well, is the ease with which you are able to recall the information that you need for the gig. You try and simplify it as much as possible. You try and make it as clear as possible. And you, like Chelsea said, like we've both done, you develop a shorthand and you develop something that you can completely recognize that maybe total gibberish to someone else who picks up the chart, but you develop this shorthand, this way of transcribing things super fast and getting them down onto a really clear chart that helps you get from one end of the gig to the other. And having said all that, if you have the luxury of time and if you have the luxury of, you know, it not just being a one-off or being in the middle of 1,000 other gigs, I always try and learn the music just from memory. I think most people do. I think it's a lot more relaxed when you know the music and you're not relying on a chart, but it's not always possible. So there are definitely two sides to that situation. I know Chelsea's running around all day tomorrow, got 3 or 4 different things going on, 2 different gigs, totally crazy. So if I was in that position, I would absolutely be writing charts and cheat sheets and trying to make my day as easy as possible. But if I was going on the road, if I was going on a tour and I had several weeks of rehearsals and then a really long tour, I definitely wouldn't be wanting to rely on music. And I would definitely make cheat sheets when I was transcribing the music initially to learn. But I've always been a huge believer in showing up to that first rehearsal completely prepared and having all the music completely down and to memory. Again, it's all about how luxurious your time situation is, how much time you have to learn it, how much time you're going to rehearse, and how many shows you're going to be playing with one artist. So it would be super interesting to see other people's shorthands. I'm always curious about that. Or if you have any like tips or tricks or whatever it is you do, however it is you translate that to get you from one end of a gig to the other. Leave me some comments below. Chelsea and I would love to read them. And that is today's vlog done. We'll see you guys tomorrow.